From Chicago's Can TV, a look at the week's events is reported in the newspapers, in the blogs and online, and on radio and TV. This is Chicago Newsroom.
Well, hi there, and welcome to another edition of Chicago Newsroom here on Can TV. I'm Ken Davis. We begin the show today with, I just found out a few minutes before we got here that that Lois Weisberg passed away, and I just wanted to make note of that before we really do anything else on the program today. I worked for the city for a while and had the privilege of working with her, and worked with her many times before that when I was in public radio. And I just think that she was one of the real mothers of our modern city in so many ways. She did so many good things for culture in Chicago. And of course, if you know Chicago's recent modern history, she was very significant in the programming of the early days of Millennium Park and Taste of Chicago, the Cows on Parade, whatever it is. Lois Weisberg made a real impression on the city of Chicago. I was glad to have known her, and it would have been inappropriate to have begun the show today without mentioning that. So thank you, Lois, for everything you did. But that's not all that's breaking this morning. On the way into the studio, I get this message on my trusty phone that the Cook County Democrats met this morning. Now, the last time they met, they decided that they were so unhappy with Anita Alvarez that they were not going to endorse anybody in the race for Cook County's attorney, state's attorney, which, of course, is probably, arguably, the most significant race that's coming up on the March 15th elections. But this morning, they got together because enough of them had changed their minds, and they decided to endorse Kim Foxx. They did not endorse Donna More, who is our guest on the program here today. So Donna More, this is probably your first public utterance since being there this morning, because you put your name out there. You must be devastated that you didn't get the endorsement.
No, I'm not devastated. In fact, I think it's actually good for my campaign. I have said from the beginning that of the three of us running, I am independent and my other two opponents are politically tied, and in particular, Kim Foxx to Tony Preckwinkle. And the proof is in the pudding this morning.
Well, I mean, it's interesting. I don't think we need to waste a lot of time on this, but it is kind of, it's a sort of a statement on the times we live in, that the political organizations, the county organizations and the city organizations, seem to be so much less significant than they were some time ago. And I think you could probably make an argument that being the recipient of this award is almost a kind of a tainted thing to have at this point.
I think that is the argument. I think that the voters in our county are tired of politics as usual. I think they're tired of the lack of service they're getting from their elected politicians. And so I think this has very little weight with the voters of Cook County.
Now, of course, significantly, in this March 15th election, we're going to have three women running for the office, a Latina, an African-American, and an African-American, a Latina, and you, we just call you, I guess, a white woman, someone born and raised in Evanston, I guess. So in these polarized times where race counts for so much, this is going to be a very interesting race, just in that aspect alone.
Our community, I agree, is polarized, but this office, the state's attorney's office, has to rise above race, politics, money, uniforms, because the job of the Cook County State's Attorney is to prosecute crime no matter who commits it. Mm-hmm. And the problem is that hasn't happened. And that's why I think the voters in our county have lost the trust of the state's attorney's office, have lost trust in the state's attorney's office.
You've said that you think that Kim Foxx, who is a former chief of staff to Tony Preckwinkle, would be too beholden to Tony Preckwinkle, and others have made the same comment. What do you base that on? I mean, why would you believe that she wouldn't be able to be an independent voice if she were to win?
A number of things. The first thing is, would Kim Foxx be able to run without Tony Preckwinkle pushing her out there? And the answer to that question is no. Kim Foxx was in the state's attorney's office, but had a fairly undistinguished legal career. let her law license lapse when she left because she was going to work for the county in a non-legal job. So this was not really a passion of hers, because if it's a passion to be state's attorney, you don't let your law license lapse. And then when Tony Preckwinkle went to do her power grab with many of the offices in the county, the state's attorney's office being one of them, Kim, just days before the August endorsement session, had to reactivate her license because Tony was putting her forward. And Kim was not independently thinking about doing this. As I said, if you were, the evidence belies that fact. And she worked for Ms. Preckwinkle. I don't think she was chief of staff for the whole 2 years she was there. But she was the chief ethics officer at one point for the county. And, you know, if you look at the campaign contributions, they go hand in hand. Who contributed to Tony's campaign? Who contributed to Kim's campaign? Anecdotally, Tony Preckwinkle spends lots of time making calls, leaning on contributors to give to Kim's campaign, because Kim came out of public service. It's hard to raise money when you come right out of public service unless you have somebody doing it for you. So, in my opinion, she's beholden both because she's been put forward and Tony's using her clout because she wants to control the office, and Tony directly or indirectly is funding the campaign.
What about your own funding? You have some family money in your campaign, right?
I do. I'm happy to be beholden to myself. Mm-hmm. It's the outside influence that makes me nervous. In terms of material influence. You know, I've been very fortunate, and I was able to contribute money to my own campaign because I believe in myself, I believe in my abilities to do this job, and I believe that if I'm asking people to give me money, I need to have some skin in the game. But I'm not, you know, other than to myself, I'm not beholden to any political leader to have me do or not do something.
There was an interview you did recently with Carol Marine, and I know that the topic came up of your, help me understand this. Mm-hmm. You've worked with and for the Illinois Racing Board, and you were or are a lobbyist. Is that right?
A few corrections. I was in the U.S. Attorney's Office when the state passed riverboat gambling, and the state wanted a federal prosecutor type to be able to help oversee the industry, and I was asked to come over to the gaming board as the first chief counsel. So I was tasked with writing the rules for the industry and making sure that it remained clean and that the public could have trust and integrity in that industry. I'm very proud of what I did at the gaming board. The rules I wrote are still in place today in terms of governing the industry. There have been very little issues in that industry, except, as I like to say, for the political gubernatorial appointments to the gaming board. There have been some indictments, but the industry is very transparent. It brings in about $1.5 billion of tax dollars. Employs 15,000 plus people in our state. Tony Preckwinkle even likes the industry because she loves to tax it. So I'm proud of the job I did. When I went into private practice, we have a new lobbying law, not so new now, but it's not just what we think of as lobbying, where you go to Springfield and you lobby legislators for something or against something. I don't do that. But if you appear before an administrative agency, you also, to ask for something for a client, you also need to be registered. So I am registered because I deal with various agencies.
That's how you became lobbyist.
Yes. Right. So that's what I do.
Let's get down to the really important conversation that's at hand here. I think you could say that the day the LaQuan McDonald video became public was a significant day in the history of this whole thing that we're roiling through right now. But of course, it begins far before that, and you could argue it's been a discussion we've been having for 20 or 30 years. But specifically, LaQuan McDonald and Anita Alvarez. It took 400 days to bring around an indictment, and the critics would happily point out that that indictment came literally an hour before the press conference was held to release the video. Can you say with certitude that if you had been state's attorney, you would have been able to get the job done in less than 400 days?
Yes.
Why?
And here's why. First of all, the one thing that LaQuan McDonald did was it shined a light on an office that not many people knew about and that not many people knew what the state's attorney did. When I first announced that I wanted to run for that office, people thought I was running against Lisa Madigan. Mm-hmm. So that particular case, although there are many more like it, focused such a bright light that people sat up and took notice of our criminal justice system, and that's a good thing. In terms of how you handle the case, or how I would handle the case as state's attorney, the murder happened on August 20th, 2014. Mm-hmm. In Anita Alvarez's own words, she had that videotape by early November 2014. And once you look at that videotape, remember, it's probable cause to indict. Between the time of indictment and the time you actually go to trial, where your burden is proof beyond a reasonable doubt, there's a lot that still happens with your case. You don't just indict and then say, all right, I'll sit around till trial. There are many things you do. You talk to additional witnesses, you get lab reports, toxicology reports in. But the question is, when would you have the evidence to indict? And after you view the videotape, Anita has said this tape is horrific. Well, it was horrific on day 20. And that's why I think you could have indicted this case much more quickly and promptly and prevented people from needing to protest for justice in the streets. We would have been in a courtroom already.
Now, I genuinely do not understand this. And as I mentioned last week, we had Mick Dumke on the show from the Sun-Times, and I said I'm really embarrassed that this whole episode has shown me how little I really understand about something that I thought I did understand. And I'm really very confused about this, because Anita Alvarez says with what appears to me to be great credibility, well, you know, there were these other two investigations going on. We had the federal investigation and so forth. And my hands were tied. I could do only so much because the FBI was involved and they kind of took it away from us.
Well, let me answer. You know, I was both a former state and federal prosecutor. So the U.S. Attorney's Office does not indict on a state murder charge. IPRA, the Independent Police Review Agency, has no power of indictment. They are looking at what I would say is administrative discipline for a police officer. And so we know that even though Ms. Alvarez said she had to wait for the U.S. Attorney's Office investigation, one, she did not. She indicted the case anyway.
Because she knew the
tape was coming out. Yeah. You know, the U.S. Attorney's Office.
That's part of the confusion.
That's right. The U.S. Attorney's Office is investigating civil rights violations, mm-hmm. Maybe some issues, again, corruption issues within the police department. But they weren't investigating charging first-degree murder. Mm-hmm. That was in the purview of the Cook County State's Attorney's Office.
That's because
murder is a state, a murder charge is a state charge. And federally, now you may have an instance where, the U.S. Attorney's Office are investigating some federal charges where they may be able to incorporate some state criminal charges.
But that would be like, for example, taking away the victim's civil rights or something like that, right? That would be a federal charge?
Or, for instance, let's say there was some conspiracy and there were mail fraud or wire fraud violations, and then you also had, you know, RICO issues or whatever, so you'd have an investigation into some crimes being committed, which would be necessarily similar to state crimes. But Anita Alvarez did not have to wait for the federal civil rights investigation to end before she indicted on her state murder charge. And in fact,
would the feds agree with that if they were sitting at the table?
I believe they would. Yeah. I mean, here's what we know from a timeline.
I apologize. Yeah, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I'm my enthusiasm here. You don't believe then that there would have been conversations where she would have said to her partners in the federal government, guys, come on, I've got to get out here with this. This is important. I feel very strongly that this is a damning tape and I want the public to see it. And they said, oh no, Anita, you can't do that. We won't let you do that. You don't believe that conversation happened?
I don't believe so. And the reason why is, based on what Anita Alvarez has said publicly, the U.S. Attorney's Office did not get involved at the earliest, I think I've heard her say December of 14. I've heard some people say March or April of 15. Mm-hmm. Anita Alvarez should have indicted this case in November, before there was any federal involvement. And she could have. There was nothing preventing her from doing it. And she hasn't been transparent about what is happening. And as you said earlier, the fact that it comes out minutes before the tape comes out suggests to me that this was a cover-up.
Okay, how it's all speculation, of course, but why would she not have done it? Why would she wait 400 days, knowing that she's going to be coming up for election pretty closely after that 400 days, and that she's going to be a scapegoat? People are going to be very angry with her. Why would she do it?
Well, that's a question that only Anita can answer.
Of course, I understand.
But here's
that's why I say it's just total speculation. But yeah. I mean, help me understand why she's a political animal. Why would she do such a thing?
Political animal, and maybe she just came out on the wrong side of her political thoughts. But LaQuan McDonald is not the first case that she has stumbled on. You know, we can back up. In 2011, we had the case of Darius Pinex. Mm-hmm. We had the case of Flint Farmer. Those cases, the same police officers were involved in those shootings. No investigation by the state's attorney's office until, of course, LaQuan McDonald happened, and then everybody went back to start to investigate other situations. We had the case coming out of Glenview about a year ago where three police officers were found by a judge to have perjured themselves. State's attorney put on perjured testimony, and yet it was hidden under the rug for 8 months until the Glenview mayor shined a light and said, hey, I'm paying my police officers and they're at home on administrative leave because the state's attorney's office hasn't done anything. This is costing my taxpayers money.
An important point, by the way, that this is not just Chicago. There are cases in the suburbs everywhere in Cook County.
So. Absolutely. Yeah. So we can go back during Anita Alvarez's tenure and find case after case that has been mishandled. And so the concern is when you bring it forward to today, people have lost trust in the office. And that's the problem.
So there have been plenty of people in the last few months who've been speculating or kind of opining, I guess, that part of the problem is that the structure of the system is that the state's attorney's office is just too darn close to the police, that the state's attorney's office relies on the police for the police have to show up in court to testify. Individual police officers and commanders have pretty good relations with people inside the office. So when a police officer gets into deep, deep trouble, mm-hmm. there's a kind of a natural human bias against wanting to hurt a police officer. Do you believe that?
I think that's true, and here's how you solve the problem. You know, both of my opponents would have the feds come in or special prosecutors come in that cost taxpayers money because they don't trust themselves and the 900 lawyers that are in the office to prosecute a police shooting. I disagree. And I wrote an op-ed on this about a month ago. What you need to do is you need to form a small unit of experienced felony prosecutors, but prosecutors who will not be in a trial court every day. Because what you're referring to in terms of working with police officers, having them bring you witnesses, testifying in your cases, that does create a relationship between prosecutors and police
yeah.
officers. And I wouldn't want my day-to-day felony trial assistants in courtrooms having to make the jump of working with a police officer one day and prosecuting one the next day. So let's have a special unit where all these prosecutors are going to do is focus on police shooting cases. And those prosecutors would report direct to me, Because at the end of the day, as state's attorney, I'm the one that has to make the tough call. Everybody else in the office, as you say, works with police. And again, you know, it's not a call you want to make. I enjoy and have always enjoyed good relationships with law enforcement. They're out there putting their lives on the line. But as I stated earlier, when you are state's attorney, you have to be willing to prosecute crime no matter who commits it. If it's a police officer, if it's a lawyer, if it's just a guy walking down the street. And so once you have that unit with the direct report to the state's attorney, there are a couple of other things that you need to do. One is you need aggressive use of the grand jury, because what we saw in LaQuan McDonald was that five or six of the police officers that were witnesses, that were the bystanders, may have not told the truth in their police reports. And how do you break the code of silence? That's really what we're talking about.
That was my next question. Thank you for, thank you for answering.
And the way you break the code of silence is you have to aggressively use your grand jury. And that's something that's done much more so in the U.S. Attorney's Office than in the state's attorney. And if an officer knows that within hours or days of witnessing a police shooting, they're going to be put in a grand jury under oath, it does two things. One is it gives them the ability to tell their fellow officer, hey,
I can't do this.
I can't do this. And it also then says, I can't tell something on a police report that's not true. And by doing that, you break the code of silence. You get witnesses, police officer or civilian, that are telling you the truth in the grand jury. And you can compel testimony in the grand jury.
So the key is speeding the process up, then, is what I'm hearing you say. If you know when this has just happened and you've witnessed it, that within 48 hours you might be under oath to tell your side of the story,
That's right.
That's going to, forget the code of the code of silence, it's going to just change the dynamic completely. So then the naive question, why don't we do it that way? Why haven't we ever done it that way?
I don't know.
To my knowledge, it's never been done.
Well, one of the reasons I'm running is because I'm impatient. I want some of these things done. There are different ways to do things. You got to think outside the box here. We're at a precipice in our criminal justice system. Nobody trusts it. And we've got to roll up our sleeves and come up with ways that we can improve the state's attorney's office and the system in general. And that's what I've been doing, and I've been putting out policies about how to improve the system.
But the problem is that it appears from what we're seeing here, when you go back to Kochman and everything else, that everybody has a stake in the system as it is right now. I mean, it's like, except for the people who are getting shot out on the street, it's to almost everybody's advantage to keep this down, to keep it tamped down as much as possible. I don't know if you even want to express an opinion on whether you think the mayor actually knew more than he's let on that he has, but without defending him, I can certainly understand that everybody around him is saying, we've just got to keep this thing quiet for a while. Nobody wins if we have this out there. You know, I mean, I see what you're saying, but it seems to me that from the political operatives to the elected officials to the state's attorneys and the police and everybody else, there's a kind of a need to keep a lid on this.
Well, had Anita Alvarez done her job and indicted this case promptly when she had probable cause, I don't think we would be where we are today. In other words, it's not the police superintendent's job to indict this case. It's not the mayor's job to indict this case. The mayor should not have a part in the criminal justice system.
But if you're the state's attorney and you see this videotape and you say, this is awful, I'm indicting, and then you get a call from the mayor's office saying, no, we don't want that to happen right now. Are you able to just say, screw you, we're going to go ahead, we're going to do it anyway?
That's why you need an independent person in that job. Yeah, there might be some heavy pressures put on the state's attorney. I fully expect that there are.
Oh, there will be.
But that doesn't mean you don't do your job. At the end of the day, I don't report to the mayor. I don't report to Tony Preckwinkle, the president of the Cook County Board, which is why it's so important not to have her to control the office. I answer to the voters, and I have to do what is right. Now, sometimes they're going to disagree with what I do, but they're going to have the information to understand why I did it. I'm going to be transparent about it. But you have to do, you have to prosecute crime no matter who commits
it. So what I think I'm hearing you say is that you alone, if you could get elected, you could begin to clean this mess up. That interestingly enough, the state's attorney is such a pivotal person in this whole panoply of people who are working these cases, that you alone could begin to change what's happening in the whole landscape. You seem to believe that.
I have enough idealism left in me to believe that. I do. You know, we have 128 different law enforcement agencies in our county. We have many mayors. We have many municipal boards. We have one state's attorney. And the state's attorney has got to take the lead in the criminal justice system. And so far, for the past 7 years, that hasn't happened.
I noticed you, I think with Carol Felsenthal, you spoke favorably about Rich Daley when he was the state's attorney. But I can't help but note that history seems to have recorded that pretty much all of the Burge stuff happened while he was state's attorney, and he did nothing about it. And in fact, there even seems to be some evidence that he kind of helped cover it up. So even... I have a really hard time believing that the political forces are so layered in this that it seems hard for me to believe that there is one individual or one office that can begin to break through this stuff.
Well, two things. One is I did work for Rich Daley when he was state's attorney, and I never had a Burge case assigned to me. They were maybe in other courtrooms, but not in my courtroom. And my comment about Rich Daley was that I was pulled out of misdemeanor court very early on to work on a financial investigation for the state's attorney. And I had to issue subpoenas to some fairly big businesses in our county at the time, and had to get had to brief the state's attorney on why I needed to issue these subpoenas. And the point in that investigation that I took away was all the state's attorney ever said to me is, tell me why you need it. And I never once was told, close down your investigation or don't investigate that avenue. And that, to me, in that aspect of his job performance, sent a very good positive message. I wasn't involved in Burge cases or discussion with him, so I can't comment on that.
Did you ever work with either Anita Alvarez or Kim Foxx?
I did not.
So you've never actually professionally interacted with either of them?
I have not. Okay. No, I have not.
Well, I think we've just blown off a half an hour. I know it happens really, really quickly, and I'm sorry. But, you know, we're always here, so you can come back again.
I would love to come back. These are tough issues, mm-hmm. And what happened this morning at slating in 20 minutes was a vote count.
It was a 20-minute vote.
Yeah, which is more than they took to do the payoff for LaQuan McDonald, but not enough to fix the justice system. So I would just like to end by saying, we can't throw up our hands and do nothing. That is, as some movie said, that is not an option. We have got to try to fix this. And the voters have got to pay attention and vote for the person who isn't beholden, because that's the only way we'll fix it.
One word answer, should Mayor Emanuel resign?
Not my call.
Nah. I knew I wouldn't get it. That's why I waited till the end. All right. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Donna Moore is running for Cook County State's Attorney. And you have been watching Chicago Newsroom. It's a production of CAN-TV, and we're very glad that you're watching. You can see us here anytime and come back again next week, because we're going to be talking about The Defender with Eitan McKiley. It'll be a great conversation. Thanks. See you next week. Bye.